bananas? Do I need broccoli? Where are the apples? You know, we're making decisions, right? That's our focusing waking state mind. That's an appropriate process that we all go through. I call it the supermarket aisle mind. Okay. But most people incorrectly think that is their entire mind. That is not our entire mind. Our mind is much more vast than just the part of our mind that makes decisions to do things, like the supermarket aisle. So what the meditation does is allows our mind to expand beyond the supermarket aisle and open up these vistas within itself to allow our mind to be more creative, to be more powerful. It allows us to feel more self-confident. Why? Because we realize we're much more vast than just the supermarket aisle mind.
Now, the way this would fit with what we've been talking about on Seek Reality, everyone, is that we know that when we come to Earth, this is only one of course, many lifetimes that we live. When we come to Earth, we leave behind most of our eternal mind, and we re-access it almost immediately after our bodies die. So I guess what I'm wondering, Kelvin, is that what we're accessing, that more of our eternal mind?
Yes, that's a good way of putting it. That's a different way of languaging basically the same thing I said. So yes, we are accessing more of these other expanded areas of our mind that it's even difficult to define in language because first of all, most people don't experience this on a regular basis. Second of all, it's, you know, the people who label things haven't gotten around to experiencing it or studying it. So whatever we want to call these different nooks and crannies, I call them, these different vast areas of our minds, that's what the meditation opens us up to. And it has very practical effects in terms of not only our own inner self-confidence, but from a spiritual standpoint, opening us up to other aspects of ourselves, perhaps memories of past lives, perhaps psychic abilities, perhaps intuitive abilities that we don't normally have, but connecting with ourselves in this different way. And the key element, I think, that gets overlooked, and it's so simple, Roberta, and you and I are in sync on these little simple points that are so profound, which is simply that it connects us with ourselves. And that's rooting us in ourselves, grounding us within ourselves. Then we can expand to any expansive area of the universe we wish to. But if we're not completely grounded within ourselves, I tell people there's always a slight fear that we may not be able to get back into ourselves, into our body.
Really, that's a fear, really?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So we need to be grounded. So many people in spiritual pursuits, they want to, I want to get out. I want to astral project. I want to get out to this other
place.
I want to get out here, And that's fine as an objective if you want that. Not everybody wants to do that. But if you really want to get really out into other areas of yourself and the universe, you need to be fully grounded within yourself first. And that's what my technique does.
Okay. And so, all right, well, that would make sense. If you're accessing, so you're telling me though, that people who become good meditators, and we'll talk in the next segment about what can go wrong and therefore what can go right and how long this stuff takes to get and so on. Obviously I was being a dropout. I can never talk about that stuff. But, what you're saying is that people discover abilities they didn't know they had, like an ability to access other lives or to astral travel or to become psychic, to know things that they otherwise couldn't know. That comes out of meditating too?
All of those things could. It's not – and every individual, as you know, we live in a free will universe. So what does that mean? We are all individual. The phrase I use is we are sovereign entities. That means Roberta Grimes is different from Kelvin Chin. We may have similar interests. We may have similar views on things. We may have different views on things. We are unique, sovereign minds. We each are. And so what the meditation does is opens us up to whatever is good for us, whatever is useful for Roberta Grimes, whatever is helpful for Kelvin Chin, the personality known this time as Kelvin Chin. The meditation opens us up in that way. And so it's unique to individual, but yes, we can open up to any and all of those things that you mentioned. Here's the visual image that I give people, which is real quick. The visual image is most people are thinking that their mind is this. It's analogous to this little 8-inch plastic bucket with about 8 or 10 ping pong balls bouncing in and out. And those are like their thoughts, the ping pong balls.
Yeah. Right.
But imagine that down on the 50-yard line of this huge, vast coliseum that seats 100,000 people. And you're in there, and it's empty. You're the only one person in there. And you look way down there on the 50-yard line on the football field, and you see this 8-inch plastic bucket, and it's got a little desk lamp over it. So that's all you're aware of. The rest of this huge coliseum is not lit up. The lights, the electricity's not working. What the meditation does is takes us out of our little 8-inch plastic bucket, allows the mind to explore itself. It's still exploring itself, the vastness of itself, turning on the light switches, 500 feet this way, 100 feet that way, 1,000 feet this way, 5,000 feet that. You know, it just, and of course, the analogy breaks down because the mind is not a physical structure. But that gives people an image about what meditation does and where we are mostly starting out in this little 8-inch plastic bucket, most human beings.
So, but this continues as you meditate more and more, you get more and more of the lights turned on? Is
yes,
that what you're saying?
Yes, exactly. And eventually, so you can see where the term enlightenment kind of comes from, you know, in the way that I use this analogy anyway. And so you're lighting up more of yourself, more of your mind. We are so, we perceive ourselves and we experience ourselves, most of us, the 7.5 billion people on planet Earth, in a very limited way. What meditation does is create a more unlimited experience of ourselves.
The problem I had back when my husband and I in the 70s went to see the Maharishi, we had to go to, I think, California to do it, across the country. The problem I had was that it didn't make sense to me. It was, I think, because it was being framed in religious terms. I rejected it. And I wish now I hadn't, but obviously that's in the past. But what you've done, Kelvin, is to take out the religious aspects, right? Is that the difference? What's the difference between transcendental meditation and garden variety, I guess, meditation? Is that the difference?
Well, let me talk about that a little bit. So, yeah, because as you know, I taught transcendental meditation for 10 years, and then I moved away from the organization. And as you say, I removed the religious and cultural trappings from it. But I also made the technique itself easier and more flexible. So I haven't taught TM, just to be clear, I have not taught TM for about 35 years. But for about 10 years, I did teach it. So I give Maharishi credit, first of all. I give Maharishi Mahesh Yogi credit as a spiritual revolutionary, I call him, on planet Earth. And he's come back a number of times in this spiritual revolutionary role, not just as Maharishi, but as other spiritual teachers over the millennia. But his role typically is to come back and shake things up and make things a little bit easier and more palatable, you could say, for the general populace, the general population. So I credit him for making the technique of meditation easier than 99% of the other techniques out there, which tend to involve focus, control, concentration, clearing the mind, you know, pushing thoughts out, all that stuff that you've heard of, that everybody has heard of. I made the technique easier, the TM, and so I don't call it TM. I've removed the religious and cultural trappings from it, and I've created more flexibility with the process. So I changed the technique in that way, I would say. But most techniques out there do involve some form of clearing the mind. Mindfulness is the technique that most people are hearing about now just because the media has jumped on that term. John Kabat-Zinn, who is a religion professor at the University of Massachusetts in Amherst, is credited with coming up with that term. But he's a Buddhist, and mindfulness and the whole notion of being mindful is a Buddhist practice. So mindfulness basically is a secularized form of Buddhist meditation. All Buddhist meditation, doesn't matter whether it's Zen Buddhist meditation or mindfulness type of meditation, involves some form of focus on the breath, focus on this, focus on that.
Is that what a mantra how you say it is?
There are mantra meditations, many mantra meditation techniques out there in the world. They often involve focus on a mantra, or you could use a mandala. You could use some techniques, use a candle. They're externally focused. Sufi meditation involves dancing and so forth. So there's all these different forms. My technique is an internal eyes closed meditation where if somebody sees you, they see you doing it in the airport terminal. They have no idea. They think, oh, Roberta's just taking a nap or whatever.
Right.
But there's a wide variety. The key issue is they should involve no control, no focus to be most effective in turning on what I call the opposite of the fight or flight switch that each individual, all of us have. And that's what's going to immediately lower our anxiety, balance our brain and our blood chemistry, and expand our conscious capacity for experience beyond the supermarket aisle we talked about. Because if there's focus, here's back to that visual analogy that I gave about the 8-inch plastic bucket. If we're focusing and controlling our breath in meditation or anything in our meditation, focus and control, we're staying in that plastic bucket. We're keeping ourselves in the plastic bucket.
Okay.
We are not allowing ourselves out of the plastic bucket. That's
a
critical component of any effective technique, is to allow the mind outside the 8-inch plastic bucket. Now, here's the thing. Some people will experience some form of mindfulness meditation, and they'll go, wow, it was amazing. I felt so much more relaxed. What happens is, notwithstanding the focus on the breath part of their technique, they inevitably will allow the mind to get outside the 8-inch plastic bucket a little bit. So they're like a foot, 2 feet outside the 8-inch plastic bucket. They've never been outside the 8-inch plastic bucket. And they go, wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
What I'm suggesting is, if there's no focus and control in the technique, then you can get 1,000 or 12,000 or 100,000 feet outside the 8-inch plastic bucket.
Okay.
Make sense?
So, yes. So people like my husband, who have been doing this for 40 years, probably their mind has gradually, or their ability to explore beyond the bucket, has expanded over that time.
That's right.
He still finds it very satisfying, and it's essential to his day, and maybe it sort of happens in spite of ourselves if we've...
That's a great point. So here's the thing. This is part of how I changed the teaching of the technique. In my teaching, because I started seeing, you know what? People are naturally, as they continue meditating, allowing their mind, their evolution of their own technique, in a sense. The mind inevitably, and this was a key element that Maharishi talked about, and yet I made the technique match up with this. The element of allowing the mind to go where it wants to go. The mind is going to do that. And so I said, why not match up the technique even more with that?
Yeah.
Because that is
sense.
The default, right? And so
right. So
even a Zen Buddhist monk in a monastery meditating for 15, 20 years, his or her mind will eventually do what you just described. So I said, why not fast forward this and make that part of the technique?
Absolutely right. Oh, that makes perfect sense. Now, what are the mistakes people make that maybe make it harder to meditate?
I think the biggest mistake is what I just mentioned, which is focus and control, concentrating, thinking that they have to somehow, even on a subtle level, have to clear their mind or push thoughts out.
That was my problem. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's
monkey
a subtle
mind
thing.
Does not go away. Yes.
Yeah, thoughts are bad. You know, you hear that all the time.
Yes.
Thoughts are bad in meditation. Even trying to relax is a form of focus and control. So this is common in guided meditations. You're at a yoga class, you're at a workshop for a weekend or whatever, and somebody does a guided meditation. I'm not saying that you cannot get some benefit from a guided meditation. Absolutely. You got some YouTube, you got an app or something that